to talk to you about this morning is some of these very thoughts. So let's go. Are you ready, Kim? All right, so let's go to our books of Philippians chapter 2, and we're looking, we've just come off of, well, let's go back to, I think we stopped at 11 is where we were, but I went a little bit farther in our lesson, so we're starting at 12. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. And that, again, we've kind of hit on and talked about a little bit, ladies, but this working out your own salvation, I really, just this whole paradox of God's sovereignty and our free will has really been something that has fit really in hand and glove with what we studied in Genesis. And when we're looking at this whole thing of God's salvation came to us at creation. At creation, when God said, let there be light. That God revealed himself to what was going to be his creation. And so when he created man, I have no idea what that garden experience was like. We have such little information about it. But the fact is that we know several things about it, that it was wonderful, because it was Eden was the dwelling place of God. That was God's first home. And he made his first home with Adam, which was humanity, men and women, because in God, there is literally both feminine character and male character, his loving, nurturing, and his powerful leading, and his powerful control, the sovereignty of God. But there's also this gentleness, this kindness, this nurturing, guiding part of God. And God kind of, interestingly enough, placed those in two totally different forms, male and female. Both God joined together, a picture of God. Unity. When we're married and we live in discord and criticizing, which we do, because I'm going to just take it a step back, which I don't know if I talked about this last lesson or not, but here's what happened. Those first 11 chapters in Genesis is an introduction to God and to God's creation of a beloved, a wife, a lover. It actually talks about in the very old Hebrew that God in the garden was the husband, and Adam was his spouse. And it talks about when they were put out of the garden, Adam divorced God. God did not divorce Adam. Adam made the choice by choosing to be God, that he divorced God. And God drove him out of his home, because God no longer had access to his inner being. Man said, I don't want you in there. And they turned like that, and Adam immediately began to criticize Abel. Cain immediately began to say, Abel relates to God differently than I do, and I don't like that. And he killed him over religion. Because he didn't see it the same way Abel did. And humanity turned on humanity, and humanity turned on the world and God's creation. And we've been in the business ever since of destroying each other. But in the garden, there was unity, perfect, beautiful unity with us and God. And when we chose to be God, that unity divided. When we are in relationships and we take on the role of God by being judgmental, we divorce ourselves from the light. Because look what Adam did. When Adam lost the light, the first thing he did is, it's Eve's fault. She did this. And Eve's like, I didn't do it. Satan did it. I was tricked into this. They knew immediately when the Spirit of God left them, when they disobeyed and chose something other than God, they felt it immediately because they recognized they were no longer one. They were naked. They were no longer in unity. And disunity began in the world. Violence against each other. And when it continued to a certain point, it got to the point where so much darkness that the light was in danger of disappearing as God stopped the progress of the flood and said, I will redeem my remnant in the place of heart, which was the eye of the storm. And God destroyed everything in the eye because it had lost its ability to reflect light. Why did he destroy Sodom and Gomorrah? Was it because of sodomy? More so than it was about gayness. It was about destroying other people's lives with your desire. They were ready to go in and kill the divine. Rape the divine. Why did God destroy Sodom and Gomorrah? Was it because of homosexuality? It was because of the loss of human love and dignity. And they were willing to kill and destroy even their own, which was Lot, who was probably one of their own very own politicians in that city. He was trying, he gets a lot of angst towards sin, saying how horrible he was for compromising and living there, but the fact was he was the only light there. He was the only light. And Abraham, the lesson was for Abraham, love. And God said, Abraham, I'm going to destroy that city because they lost their ability to love each other. They're so unnatural in their behaviors. And Abraham said, but there's light. Wait, what about the light that's in there? There's got to be some light. And God said, I'll investigate the light. God knew what was in there. And he went in and brought Lot and his daughters out, and the wife who still longed for that darkness. And literally, it was a lesson of bringing them out of darkness and trying to move them back into light at Abraham's petition. Abraham loved Lot. He was like his son. He was the only promise he had at the moment because he had no children. He had nothing to have any kind of prosperity or any kind of legacy. And so he loved Lot. He didn't want Lot destroyed with the world. The world's headed to destruction. And we're the only light it has because God is in us and Christ is in us. And so when Paul's talking here and exhorting them and saying, you work out your own salvation, in essence he's saying, teach the world to live in that light. That joy is there. That's where the peace, contentment, the joy, the fulfillment, the easing of that empty place in us, the contentment. And so that is found through not trying to be God and being judgmental and trying to control how other people's lives are going to end. That's hard to put into practice because in me working out my own salvation, I have to also be willing to let my son work out his own salvation. Does that mean he's doing it through works? No. It means that God is working in him to make him into Christ. Not to become Christ, but to become like Christ in such that he's in unity with Christ, and then the world is affected differently when we are in unity. Because what we give out is no longer tainted by our own darkness. We're giving out light, purity, not our own expectations and our own thoughts and preconceived ideas. And that's really hard because out here we look at the world and we go, well, it's a mess. Well, yes, because the lot of the world is in them the truth of how to get out of that suffering? Can we fault them because they don't know the truth? They don't understand? They're not living in joy? We should love them and be sad that they don't have to suffer that way. We have the answer for suffering. And so basically, he's saying, let them work out their salvation also. It is a call. Paul is saying, being in unity, don't criticize. And that whole first part of that chapter, he's saying, be in unity. And that unity basically means, it says, look at this, it says, by being of like mind, he says, fulfill my joy, be of like mind. And then he says, let this mind be in you, in number 5, which was also in Christ Jesus. And then he says, therefore done 12, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not in my presence, but now also in my absence, work that out in fear and trembling. Have such a reverence for what God is doing in you that you don't even want to interfere with it. That you have such reverence and awe of that he loves you enough to change. When you ask him to come into you, he takes that so serious that the Godhead floods and invades you, brings you back to life, your spirit back to life, fills you with new wine, which is the joy of the Lord, and anoints our head, our mind, with oil, which is the healing balm of Gilead, that oil that cleanses and perfects our mind and draws us out of the criticism and the negativity that we see towards those around us and even towards our own self, the negativity and criticism. And we start looking for, just like Paul did with these two men, Timothy and Epaphroditus, these two men, he began to look for God in people. Instead of looking at Timothy and saying, Timothy is a wonderful pastor, he is loving, he's been trustworthy, but he does have one fault. Timothy, you know, let me tell you, things you need to look out for, Timothy. Paul didn't find the bad in the people that he worked and associated and ministered with. He found light in them. So when my child or your child has made a decision, or even someone you live with and love, is not acting like God, and that's the whole thing, is we're looking at them and saying, that's not God. You need to change your behavior. But the fact is, me judging them is not acting like God, and I need to change my behavior. We're so controlled, even in a sense, by our own love, which is not necessarily agape love. It is more of a human love that wants to control. It wants to almost, in idolatry, say, I can do it better than God. Because God says, take your hands off of it and let me do it. He's done a work in my life over the last year. And I'll tell you, the way this works, and you're not going to like it, but it's brokenness. The Lord takes us all the way down, breaks us, and brings us to a point of finding our need for him so much bigger than our own desires. And to begin living out in fullness and joy, and not concentrating. And an example I gave last night and yesterday in the lesson was Billy. I mean, Billy is one of the most precious men on this earth, and I tell you, I just love him. But for years, I've been hard on him, because I expected things done my way. And so, bless his heart, he would go in and make some cookies for the kids, the grandkids, and he loves to bake. And he'd go in and he'd bake cookies, and he'd make, like, I'm not kidding, at Thanksgiving, he made 500 cookies.
Oh my.
I'm not kidding. He loves to make cookies. He loves to bake for people and take them things when they're suffering and they're having a hard time. He's got this generous, loving spirit. So he goes to the kitchen. He's doing something for God. And I'm like, that's wonderful. He's in my kitchen. because Billy doesn't clean the kitchen the way I do. Does anybody have anybody that cleans the kitchen the way you do? Anybody in the house, my children, or somebody you hire, anybody? No, nobody cleans it the way you do. It's your kitchen. And that's the way God is with us. I am God's kitchen. Nobody's going to clean it up the way God does. Nobody. I can't clean it up the way God does. Only God can. And so I go into the kitchen and I'm like, Billy's been here. There's cookie dough dripping down the counter. But he's washed all the tissues. He's put them all away. He's put all of his ingredients away. He's even gotten on the floor on his hands and knees and scrubbed up the file that he dropped all over the floor. He's done his very best to please me. And when I walk into the kitchen and I go, I hate when he comes in here. This is such, he makes so much work for me. And I start trying to clean that kitchen and I'm in resentment and anger and going, I don't understand why you can't just come in here and wipe off the counter. I mean, it's just finish the job. It's like you're 80%. Why can't you do the 100%? And then I realize, well, you do about 80% of every job you do. Do you do 100% on every job? Why do I require someone else to do 100% if I myself cannot do 100%? And so I recognize it takes me about 3 minutes to sweep up that little crumb, put it in the trash, which is important to me, not anybody else, because I don't want the crumb on my counter, because I'm a little bit OCD. And so here it is, I've cleaned it up, put it away, and now my attitude, bingo, Melinda, is what changes the course of how I'm feeling for the rest of the day about the person I'm supposed to love more than anybody else on this earth. And I've turned into a critical spirit that has said, you didn't do it my way. Therefore, it's not good enough. And I'm not pleased with everything else you've done, because you left the crumbs on the table. And God doesn't do that to us because we have crumbs all over our house and the side of us. We are nothing but a mess. Mm-hmm. And He cleans us up. No one can clean us up the way He does. There is no one who can get in us and clean us up the way He requires for us to be. It's a process that He died to have exclusive rights to. We have no rights to ourselves. And He has exclusive rights to train me to live according to His preference. And as He's doing that in me, He's also doing that in Billy and in Adam, my son, and my grandkids, who are living and making choices that I'm like, And God is saying to me, you love them as I love them. You see me in them as light. And then you do not look for the things to criticize, but you look for the things to celebrate. And when you do that, you have joy. When you don't, you have misery. It's that simple. It's choosing life or death. Negativity, positivity. And we get real weirded out, like, you know, when people talk about positive living. But the fact is when we live a negative lifestyle, we don't only influence our own self and bring our own self down, we bring everybody around us down too. But when we lift those people up around us, and we live in a sense of celebration of their lives, regardless of where they are, then God does the healing and changes them and us. And I'm going to give you this example, and I don't know what time it is, I'll just tell you. Here's the example that I use in my life, and again, I'm going to share this, and I'm just going to share it. My grandson is gay. He has come out as gay. And that really shook my world. It did. And God, also, I had a huge collapse with what I believed my son was and who he was and where he was going. And I had built a perfect world in my mind. I had two sons that were pastors, my husband a pastor, I'm a pastor's wife. My life was this pretty little package that I had given to God and said, didn't I do great? Look at my family. What a blessing. I must be having all this blessing because I've been obedient. I'm so blessed. And then it all fell apart. And it was my house of cards. It wasn't God's. It wasn't mine. And it fell. And when it fell, I was like, well, I don't know who God is. What am I supposed to do next? I don't understand how to respond with, how do I respond biblically without condoning and yet loving? What is it? That's impossible. That's again one of the paradoxes. It's again the opposites. How do I do that? And what God gave me was a precious, precious example. And when Sandy was told about what her chemo was going to be like, the doctor said to her, well, in fact, three doctors said to her, you're going to lose your hair probably within the first few treatments because it's strong stuff. And Mom hadn't lost her hair much. She lost thinned, but she'd been in treatment a long time. I think we kind of had hoped that Sandy wouldn't lose her hair. Gosh, she has beautiful hair. You have gorgeous hair. And so we were really hopeful that, you know, maybe it could thin and we could, you know, well, they said it's going to go. It's going to go. So she took a proactive approach, and she said, I'm just going to have my head shaved. We'll get a nice wig, which she did, I'm just going to go ahead and do it. So she said, ask Ethan, my grandson, if he would shave her head. He's a hairdresser. So I called him, and he said, yeah. God had already been working on me with a lot of this with Ethan, and I had already reached out to him. And he and I were in a renewing time where I was learning to love him where he was at, and he was learning to trust me to love him where he was at, which is tough when someone's been through a lot of hurt. And so, with a lot of bullying, a lot of hurt, there's reasons that people make choices. And so, anyways, he's hurt. He's a hurt kid who's dealt with bullying his whole life. And I'm like, well, you know, I'm not making excuses for why people do things, you know, more than them. We have this in God's Word, and this, and I don't understand how we discern between, recognizing that something is not going in the right direction and sharing that with family without being judgmental. And I don't know how to walk this line, God. I just don't. This is ridiculous. I don't know how. This is impossible. A line to carry. And God said, you love them. You love them like you're loving me, like you see me in them. Look for me in them. Because my kids accepted the Lord and my grandkids accepted the Lord when they were very young. And so I said, okay. It was kind of one of those things where, like, I don't have anything else I know to do, so all right, I'll try that. And what happened was Sandy and I embraced my grandson and even his friend. And not embracing in a sense of condoning, but embracing in a sense of loving, hugging, cherishing, seeing value in as a person, as somebody that has a need. And so we were there getting here, and I walked in, and there I had never met this young man before, and he was sitting back in the corner, and he was very shy, very quiet, with hands between his legs, very quiet. And I was like, hi, I didn't know who it was. I was like, hi, how are you? And I said, what's your name? And he said, Austin. And I was like, hi, Austin, how are you doing? It's so nice to meet you. And, you know, and immediately God said, that is, he's here with Ethan. And I thought, and I'm just being real honest, but my first thought was, oh my gosh, how am I handling this today? We're here to do something that's so emotional, so hard. My brain was going, what do I do? How do I do this? How do we move forward? This is a very tough emotional moment that we're going to walk through right here, shaving Sandy's head and kind of releasing something into God's hands that is really heavy. We've invited my grandson into the situation because we love him, and I trust his gentleness and his kindness, and he's so giving, he's compassionate, he's a good kid. And so he comes, and
He says to Sandy, how do you want your hair done? And Sandy's like, I want it all off, shave it. He said, well, I can just like leave it real close and don't make anything more uncomfortable. And so he said, I just cut this young man's hair over here. Do you want to see it? And Sandy's like, yeah. The boy came over. And Sandy touched his hair. No, she said, just shave it all. And the Lord impressed on me, and I'm not saying anything is great about what I did, it was just God teaching me something. God whispered in my heart, you go there and put your arm around him. Austin. Complete stranger. Somebody that most of the times I would have avoided because it would have been an uncomfortable situation. And I would never put my arm around him. Big tears rolled up in his eyes. And as he said, my mama died of cancer. And he began to talk to me about his mom's journey in cancer. And I was able to share with him very quietly about the experience of how God had walked with us through the cancer. And he came over, I moved back over on the other side of Sandy and put, and Ethan had put this, the cape around him. And I was standing there with my hands under the cape, holding her hand. Just loving on her. And Austin came over and he was standing beside me, and I kind of had my arm around him. And Ethan reached down and he put his arms around Sandy from behind. And he reached down and wiped her tears away. And then he kissed her and put his face against her face in the presence of the Lord. And it was supernatural. The whole shop came to a quiet standstill. It was like, everybody was watching what was going on. And Ethan so gently and so preciously shaved her head and loved on her and touched her and comforted her and wiped tears. And I saw Jesus in Ethan. And I was like, I don't want to ever hurt that child. He's been hurt. My job is to love him back to perfection, which is what Jesus is doing with us. He sees me as perfect and he's loving me back to perfection. We are to love our children back to God's perfection. He's in charge of that. I can't do that. I have no idea how to do that. All I can do is love as God takes the steps back towards perfection. What if I never see it? What if I never see the point of my longing to see those things weeded out of my loved one's life. And God said, none of your business. You focus on weeding out of you the things that are blocking you from loving. And that's what God's working on. Me. To recognize that God is working in Billy. And that Billy's perfect. I don't have to change Billy. I couldn't if I tried. My joy is to love Billy in his journey, in the progress that he's making, and celebrate each victory. I'm to do that with my children. I'm to do that with my pastor. I'm to do that with the people that God brought into my life. I'm to do that with the stranger and expect that the glimmer of conscience, that the memory of God that is in them, that my love to them will spark their interest in finding that light themselves. That doesn't come through judging them. It comes through loving them. And that's what God has given us in this chapter. He says, you want unity in this woman's group? You want unity in your home? You want unity in the body of Christ? You want unity with God? To be like-minded? And stop being negative and look at the glory of God in someone else and say, you're a miracle. My grandson's a miracle. He's such a beautiful individual that God has created to share so much love in the world. I pray God never lets my negativity squash out that light. for it everywhere I see it, whether it is in the mountain beauty of God's creation, or if it's in the simple, simple voice of small bird. That God's presence is in me, and that song that God sings in nature can sing out of me and touch everything, and make my life become so abundant and exciting, because my joy now becomes to be God's joy. I want to be God's joy. I want to do work. I can't compete with somebody who cooks all the time and takes things that everybody has so gracious. That's not who God created me to be. God created me to minister in a different way. So celebrate who God has made you to be, and then utilize those beautiful things about yourself to love others and see those things in them. That's what will bring peace to our world. And it can only start by a very humble beginning of that enemy flowing out in the ripples of God's love. It is example that teaches people how to avoid consequence. It is not our words. It's our example. You don't have any questions, comments?
Amen.
Well, it's kind of raw. I'm in a place right now where I'm sort of raw, guys. God is really changing. He's weeding out a lot of darkness in you. And when you get weeded out of darkness, you make more room for more light. And God just fills you up and makes life good. So we need to be good to each other. We need to be kind to each other. We need to be, even in every aspect of our lives, politics, family, world crisis, immigration, everything that we have as turmoil, conflict that people don't agree, let's go to God's opinion of it and say, Lord, you're in me. I don't even know how to respond to the world's pain, but let your love be that balm that has healed my mind to flow out and be an extension of touch to flow into everybody else's life around me that I love. That's how I love, is by releasing them to God. And if I never see the fruition of God's work in their life, it's still my promise, just like Abraham's promise. It's mine. There's no doubt. There's no confusion. I don't have to worry about it. The work, because of salvation in them, the work is done. And God is everything else is promised. In me, and in you, and in those God has assigned you to love. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we love you, and it is amazing.